we make a song. Voice by voice we sing it. Choir by choir we fill up the room with the music that we bring in.
Love grows one by one, two by two, and four by four.
Can stop one heart from breaking, I shall not live in vain. If I can ease one life the aching, or cool one pain, or help a fainting robin unto shall not live in vain. I shall not live in vain. I shall not live in vain. If I can help one fainting robin unto his nest again, I shall not live in vain. 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 I shall not live
Go have a seat. This is not going to take long. Okay. Good morning. And welcome. Welcome to First Unitarian Church. It's wonderful to have you all here this morning. And, you know, I especially appreciated the very first song that you sang this morning, Love Grows, 2x2, or 1x1, 2x2, 4x4. And since love is such an important part of this church, we're actually going to be spending our time this morning in worship talking about ways that this church can grow. The way you want to make love grow, we want to make this church grow. And following the service, we're going to have an annual meeting to discuss that further. But in the meantime, let me get some ideas from not only the choir, any other kids out there? You know, just, okay, let me just turn to the choir. Give me some ideas of how to make this church grow. Yeah, go ahead. How? Tell other people about it. Okay. And how would you say that to other people? What would you say? Guess what? There's a great church on 1300 East. Right, Rosie? Is that what you? Yeah, okay. What other ideas? How do you make the church grow? We're a little short on ideas, too. Yeah. What about the choir? Would you like to have more kids in the junior choir?
Yes.
Yeah. That is an exact mirror of this congregation. There are some who do not want to grow, and others say it. Okay. Give me a good reason for wanting more kids in the choir. A bigger sound. Yeah, and this church could use a bigger sound as well in the city. And why not have the junior choir grow? Because you would know, oh, you have to make changes. More steps, yeah, and what else? You're already pretty crowded, yeah. So let's just keep things as they are. That is the tension, yeah. Yeah, print more music, the costs go up and up. Let's stay small, absolutely.
But keep everything the way it is.
Okay, keep everything the way it is. Okay. Remind me not to ask you to join the board of trustees, you know. Thank you. Thank you for your ideas representing both sides, just like the adults. It's time to light the chalice, and I think we're lucky. I think, Isaac, you're going to light the chalice? That's wonderful. Let's make room for Isaac to come up and light the chalice.
Hey, sorry.
Hey. That's so light. Let's make this easy. Take that light. Good, you got it. Beautiful. Isaac, that's great. Thank you so much. And shall we say the words together, or do you want to say the words by yourself?
Sure, because I'm about too good of a
word. Okay, so let's say them, but here they are. Symbol of light,
symbol of knowledge,
symbol of warmth,
symbol of freedom.
We light this chalice as a symbol of our faith. Here we gather to celebrate hope and the infinite possibilities of love. Isaac, thank you so very, very much. Our junior choir will direct us for the opening hymn. They're going to sing it through twice, and then all of us will rise and join the junior choir.
Don't
We still didn't get the kick line in. I don't know what happened. Next time. Okay. We'll work on that over this summer. Good morning. As we gather as a community in worship, each week we do so with joy and with struggle to face the truths of our lives and the world around us. And one of the ways that we do this is by gathering in silence to turn towards that which we find most holy for prayer, for reflection, and for contemplation. And so I invite you now to turn with me towards that silence. Most holy and beloved Spirit of life, breath that we breathe and that breathes us, heartbeat that we live. Thank you for this day that we gather and are reminded in laughter and in longing of those things which we hold most dear, of love, of community, of purpose, and of being serious at looking at those things that stand in the way of what we hold most dear. As we gather, we come with hopes and longings, with celebrations, and with despair and doubts and fears for ourselves and our world. As wildfires blaze and wars are fought, so too street signs are unveiled and bathrooms are made accessible. We see movements for justice and movements of greed and violence and hatred. Help us to see our world more clearly and ourselves in it. Help us to see the signs of our times, the directions that they point, and the directions of our own lives. And help us to bend those directions more towards justice and towards love. To these imperfect words, we add the silent intentions of our hearts. May our prayers be heard, our hearts be restored, and our hope be renewed. Amen.
The author of our reading this morning will be familiar to some of you. Jay Leach has been out to First Church here in Salt Lake a couple of times. I believe the last one may have been in 2012. I've had the privilege of being in his home church in Charlotte, North Carolina. So he is obviously a UU minister and one of our leading ministers across the whole denomination. And when I first read this piece, this was composed just within the past few months, I thought, oh, what a downer. God, that's really discouraging. And then I read it for a second time, and I said, you know, he raises some really crucial questions that that all churches should be asking at this time. So I want you to hear this as though it's the second time that you're hearing it. So I don't want to bring anybody down. I just want you to hear the real salient, poignant parts. It has become a regular part of our summers in South Carolina, an excursion to Hunting Island State Park on the coast about 20 miles from Beaufort or Buford. We take a picnic, swim in the surf, walk a secluded trail alongside the lagoon, and conclude our day watching the sun go down over the marsh. Each year, we enjoy a climb to the top of the handsome black and white lighthouse. We venture up 167 spiraling steps to a platform 132 feet above the ground. This offers cool breezes, a sweeping view of the coastline, and an eye-level encounter with massive pelicans gliding. The Hunting Island Lighthouse was originally built in 1859. The bright beacon from its lens could shine 18 miles, warning passing ships of sandbars and shallow water. Destroyed during the Civil War, it was rebuilt in 1875, only to be taken apart and relocated a mile and a quarter from its original location due to erosion and an encroaching shoreline. For more than seven decades, this lighthouse served to warn and protect. But in 1933, it was deactivated, no longer needed or useful. Now this grand brick and steel structure serves only as a historic site. While it shines a beacon, that beam is decorative, not bright enough to aid in navigation. The lighthouse is still a pleasant relic we enjoy each summer, but it has long outlived its important function. Some say the same of organized religion. When serving as an important, even primary aspect of society, it too has become obsolete. Venturing into many European towns, we find grand cathedrals, sites around which whole towns developed, now relegated to tourist destinations. Oh, they're still grand, awe-inspiring even. They just represent an institution, religion, that some claim has outlived its value in the larger society. What happens when lighthouses and cathedrals no longer offer something essential? They're reduced to tourist stops, quaint places to visit, but of little real value to the larger communities. They may be preserved, appreciated for their histories, but no one's now looking to them for guidance and direction in these challenging times. Is obsolescence the truth? Not just about cathedrals, but about organized religion in general. Should we concede that religion's scant beam may offer a quaint decorative element? Its temples, synagogues, mosques, and sanctuaries may still have historic significance, but is it all now just a vestige of a once essential place in life? Have we, as a liberating religion,
we as a congregation come to the end of our real value? Have we become a place to visit occasionally, but not a place to which our community would look for guidance or inspiration? We are a beacon of progressive thought and action, we say in defining our claims. Is that really true? Can people still see our welcoming light? Do we serve to enlighten the community? Are we really guiding our city away from dangerous shoals? Do we collectively offer something essential, not just for our members, but to our region? Or have we become a quaint place to drop in on occasion, to show our kids every once in a while, but without any real role in a city and region so dramatically different from the one we entered decades ago? A familiar hymn we sing asserts, "Stand we now upon the threshold, facing futures yet unknown." Looking back to our forebears and forward with a still essential vision, this hymn declares, "Guard we ever their sacred embers written in each heart and mind. Guard we ever their sacred embers. Ever, ever, guard we ever." We were a beacon, or we are a beacon. That choice is ever before us. Now, whether or not we will remain a beacon for this community remains to be seen, but we will certainly forever have announcements. I promise you that. Please take a look at the abundance of announcements in your order service. Let me just highlight a couple, and I'll try to do this in some chronological order. I want you to please note that on Thursday night from 7 to 9, it'll be really a tremendous privilege. Matthew and I will do a Unitarian information session, orientation, get new people or newish people acquainted with Unitarian theology and its history, and it's a good way to kind of get on board and catch up. And that's going to be this Thursday at 7 o'clock, 7 to 9. And then on Friday, There will be what is being billed as the first annual Blackburn Music Festival, which will be at the home of a wonderful couple in our congregation up in Bountiful. And they're going to host a truly wonderful evening of music. There will be our Madrigal Mystery Tour, wonderful singers, and also David Owens and Becky Heal will be doing some Cole Porter in the Parlor. You can get tickets for that in Elliott Hall, following the service. This is a fundraiser, gotta remember that. It's a fundraiser, $50 will get you an absolutely fun and brilliantly musical evening this Friday. And then on Sunday, next Sunday, we are going to have, the choir will perform a requiem, which it does traditionally, probably for the last decade or so. This is a requiem, however, kind of, it's kind of a home brew, and it's just fantastic. It involves the lyrics of Kathleen Cahill, who is a member of our congregation, as well as the music of David Zabriskie, who's part of our music program. The instrumentation is going to be huge, the choir spectacular. Please be on hand next, both services at 9 and 11 for the wonderful requiem. Also, just another a reminder, as I reminded the kids earlier, there's a very important annual meeting right after church today. If you're worried about your grumbling stomachs because the thing will start at 12:30, our junior high kids will be selling sandwiches to nourish us through the annual meeting. This is, again, a fundraiser for them to support their trip to Boston, where they'll be going in June to get better acquainted with our Unitarian Universalist history. As of now, the offering will gratefully be received, a chance to greet one another and to welcome each other, and be sure to stay for the annual meeting. Remind your neighbors, stay for the annual meeting.
Thank you.
Long ago, I had a German friend who attended Star King, our Unitarian seminary in Berkeley, California. And after earning his ministry degree, he went back to his town of Offenbach, a suburb of Frankfurt, where he would serve as a Unitarian minister. His name was Helmut Manteuffel. And if you have any knowledge of German, you know that what it meant that when we affectionately refer to him as a devil of a man, Manteuffel, Teufel's devil. Anyway, Unitarianism in Germany was new to me at the time, and so I asked Helmut how many members were in his church, and he said, about 10,000. I was startled. I kind of laughed nervously, and he said, no, really, and he said, that's actually nothing. Frankfurt next door has more than 20,000. Okay. How many ministers are on staff at this 10,000-member church in Offenbach? And he said, oh, just me. I found this quite puzzling until I traveled to Offenbach one summer and visited Helmut. I was terribly excited about attending the Sunday morning service in a Unitarian church that had 10,000 members, one minister, and only one worship service. As I approached the church, which had on its steeple a circle, and inside the circle was a cross in which it said, it was engraved, Dem Ewigen, or the Eternal One. And I noticed that it was awfully quiet just before church started. You figure, you know, there's always this mad rush right before a service starts, and boy, it was awfully quiet there. The sanctuary could seat, oh, maybe 300 or 400 people, but gathered there that morning were a few elderly ladies, perhaps a dozen or so. The service was short, informal, and friendly. But when it was over, and after I was kindly introduced to the whole congregation, everyone just dispersed, went about their way, and that was the end of it. So I said to Helmut, scratching my head, 10,000 members? On the books, he said. Then my education really began. Germany, like most of Western Europe, is highly secular. They have no use for religion, which is regarded mostly as, you know, superstitious and irrelevant. However, the church institution is preserved by the government. Helmut is paid mostly by the government, which preserves the church for a few traditional ceremonies. The Unitarian Church in Offenbach is available for baptizing newborns, running a confirmation class, which actually always has very few participants, performing weddings, and for holding memorials. You know, not even Christmas or Easter carries much sway. There are no social justice programs. There's no religious education for kids or adults. There's no board of trustees. Kind of a foreshadowing of what a seriously secular society may look like. Wow. I've been aware of empty churches, actually for a long time, having served as a supply preacher in Massachusetts to Unitarian Universalist churches throughout my student years. I spoke mostly at Universalist churches, each church owning this just huge arc of a building that once proudly held several hundred members. And they had dwindled down to about 15 or 20 on a Sunday morning. None of these churches had a minister, and they kept the building operational by spending down their endowment. As a student, I always appreciated the $50 honorarium, but I felt a distinct sadness in the pit of my stomach that these churches were simply unsustainable. And since I was going to enter the field of ministry, I couldn't help but wonder what fate lay in store for me and for the future of our denomination. One of my professors and mentor during my undergraduate studies tried very hard to dissuade me from entering the Unitarian ministry. He said, the liberal church is dead. Forget about it, Tom. Move on. Look at something else. It's dead. That was 1971. Well, obviously, I pursued the ministry and am glad I did. But you know, I'll always remember trying to find the divinity school on my first visit to Cambridge. Those were the days before GPS could take you to any destination, you know, virtually blindfolded. So I broke down and I did the very unmanly thing. I asked for directions. And with some help, I finally stumbled onto Divinity Avenue. Wow. But I'll never forget the sign. Divinity Avenue, dead end. So, I think we all understand that progressive thinkers, progressive people generally, entrenched in scientific worldviews, comprise the overwhelming membership in liberal churches. But you know, when you think about it, they're always just one step away from complete secularization. Now, they don't need church in the traditional way in order to express piety or make peace with their God. Now, this group of people, this highly intellectual, scientific worldview kind of people, are attracted to a community of like-minded people for social reasons. And yet what gets them to the church at all, I think, is they're seeking a contemporary theology to justify the work of the church as avenues towards making the world more just. That's why they go, yeah, there's a reason. You know, I don't need church, but my goodness, they do good things. It's as though they're shining a beacon for people to follow and to see and to learn. In the 1960s, it grew apparent that liberal expressions of faith didn't provide enough sticking power, didn't provide enough glue to keep the membership intact and resist the forces of secularization. When we consider, and this is just a startling number, that the religious education enrollment for children, this is in the all Unitarian Universalist churches, the enrollment for religious education is 40% of what it was when the two denominations merged in 1961. This neglect to nurture our young people, to nurture our children in a liberal tradition has had just awful consequences for the adult numbers that have drastically fallen. But an increasing secularization in our country has seemingly affected all churches. In the last 10 years, membership in the Episcopal Church has declined by 23%. The data being collected now reflects huge drops in membership among non-liberal churches. The Southern Baptist Convention has been in a downward spiral for the last 12 years, and has struggled along with denominations like the Missouri Synod Lutherans, with membership loss, erosion of programming, and decreased staffing and budgets. Evangelical churches, despite all the publicity surrounding the importance of their support for certain candidates or not, evangelicals have, in fact, hit a membership ceiling in the 1970s. They have not risen above that number that they held in the 1970s. The Catholic Church is reeling from scandals, with many dioceses filing for bankruptcy. One statistic I found a bit curious, maybe it's just tailor-made for our congregation. In the 1940s, there were 3 Episcopalians for every Mormon. Today, there are 3 Mormons for every Episcopalian. What that says, I don't know, but the next cocktail party, you can toss that out. The rise of the nones, those who respond to surveys as having no religious affiliation. This has just exceeded 20% of our overall population. All things considered, I believe we're doing very well in the Unitarian Church in Salt Lake City, as are all UU churches that exist in church-going cultures. I look at successful churches in Dallas, certainly a church-going culture, Houston, Tulsa, Atlanta, Charlotte, Greenville, South Carolina. We are not doing so well in those liberal, secular enclaves like Boston, New York, Chicago, San Francisco. But even we need to examine the provocative questions raised this morning. Are we truly beacons of progressive thought and action? Can people see our welcoming light? Does our service, the work that we're engaged in, enlighten the community? Or have we become a quaint place to drop in on occasion? Now, I believe that if we keep our focus to the very central tenet of liberal religion itself, our church in particular, and UU churches in general, will continue to find meaning, and purpose in a growing secular landscape. After all, has not the liberal church always been a secular movement primarily, driven by a compelling moral and theological imperative? This becomes clearer when we understand the influence that Immanuel Kant wielded over our Unitarian Transcendentalists. Those Transcendentalists famously shaped not only intellectual thought about nature, politics, and society, but they were grounded in service. They were grounded in the abolitionist movement and they responded to the urgent call for equality. And this powerful influence of Kant stemmed from finally articulating the belief, the basic philosophy, that we are not merely what God ordains us to be, and I'm quoting him precisely here. We're not merely what God ordains us to be, but we create through our own deliberate acts. We create through our own deliberate acts. And this summarizes liberal religion in a nutshell. That is to say, we are not pawns of some divine destiny, but are fully capable of our own manufacturing our own deliberate acts. And this not only bears upon our meaningful pursuit of understanding the world, but also makes us acutely aware of the consequences of our actions or failing to act at all. So the very center, or the fulcrum of Kant's message is that we are destined to remake the world by reshaping ourselves. And Kant urges us to examine the world, examine ourselves, and the caveat, make them both better. Make yourself, make the world better. Now, is that not the essence of what brings people together in liberal churches? Making the world better, more just. Well, that may be just a secular pursuit, but its energy and power derives from a larger, basically religious impulse. But Kant also contributed to the idea of a moral imperative, a grander view of right behavior that transcends self-interest. And clearly, how desperately we need to hear that message today. The perspective of a moral imperative lends to our faith power, viability, even for these contemporary mindsets of ours. It still cuts mustard. Competing with this liberal religious philosophy is not only secularization, but also an economy that, despite its growth, still finds the middle class shrinking to the point where most of us exhaust ourselves by working harder and longer hours in effort to maintain a lifestyle that we would like or we'd like our children to have. We do work long and hard, and come the weekend, yes, we are exhausted. And we're also keenly aware of this new emphasis on individualism, which has really shaped a large part of how many of us navigate life, deal with commitments, and regard the church. I find this worrisome in that, you know, it's really hard for an individual to care for his or her neighbor as opposed to a congregation that provides resources and support. But what will develop, I think, inevitably is, if we continue that line, is a private morality that really encourages a lot of narcissism. And we hear this all the time these days. You know, back in the 70s and 80s, it was the me generation, and everything really seems to revolve around me, around the personhood. That seems to be taking just prime position in our thinking. Our perception of ourselves, I believe, I did not take a survey of everyone, but I believe our perception of ourselves here in this liberal church in Salt Lake City is a real good one. It feels vibrant and purposeful, and we feel it does serve the community by shining a light upon a very growing, diverse population in a conservative valley. And we kind of point our light from our beacon onto a culture that comprehends neither multiculturalism or racism or homophobia. But if we honestly scrutinize our outreach, I mean, if we really just step back a second and are honest with ourselves, if we think our welcoming light is truly discernible, we might want to reconsider. Let us not confuse historic significance with the real value we represent today. We hear a lot of stories of all those liberal institutions and theater groups that we have sprung here in Salt Lake. But what about now? What about just the last while? And what about welcoming new people? Do they really see our welcoming light? These are important considerations for us and all liberal churches to make at this time. So moving right along in some kind of a progressive fashion, I want to say in all honesty that this is going to be a very painful year for this church. A perfect storm, one might say, hit our pledge drive, where five of our top eight pledging families, for good, legitimate personal reasons, either reduced their pledges significantly or stopped pledging altogether. Now, of course, you know, every pledge drive takes its lumps, and you might expect that, oh, one or two families may experience some unexpected financial hardship. But when it affects five of your leading eight families, to me it kind of feels like this science fiction story where UFOs have decided to target this little unsuspecting Unitarian church in Salt Lake City and just let loose with horrible, horrible things. The upshot is that the loss of revenue from our top pledging families is $42,000. This is not how you want to begin a new fiscal year on July 1st. The good news The good news is that 72 families have indeed increased their pledges, while specifically noting that their rationale was for making a second minister possible to serve this congregation going forward. And so I think the overall view is that this congregation is committed, remains emphatic about fulfilling its historic charge and taking that into the future, whereby we serve the community, truly serve it as a beacon of progressive thought and action. Now, if those UFOs had not targeted our church this year, we would have ended the pledge drive with 50% of the monies needed for a second minister and a good chance of clinching that new position after next year's campaign. Instead, we find ourselves 5% behind our budget. But the means of acquiring a second minister are not completely vanquished. So much depends not only on fiscal generosity, but the generosity of giving of your time. Volunteerism is crucial. Now, I'm going to return to that in just a second. I just want to say that, kind of interrupt myself, I am frequently asked, as you may well be asking each other, I'm asked, is our church actually growing? And to me, this feels like a trick question. And I'll tell you why. You can just imagine, I hate to be throwing all these numbers at you, but just imagine, in the last 3 years, just 3 years, we have had 135 new families walk through that door, and they began pledging financially to this church. This demonstrates, I believe, most poignantly, that this congregation does indeed serve a vital role in this community. We attract interested parties. To give you some comparison, when I began my ministry here a long time ago, we only had 117 pledging families in total. So these past 3 years have far outpaced what this church once was. Good news, right? Is the church growing? Here's the trick part. Each year, we lose more families than we gain. Now, not only do numbers shrink when there are deaths or when members move, but very often people leave who do not feel particularly welcomed by our congregation, which often seems self-satisfied with the friends they already have made here. And increasingly, there is also a consumer-like attitude about church, where after you get what you wanted, you get what you paid for, the kids are done with religious education, or they're finished the OWL program, families leave. It's as if to say, since I don't get anything from the church, why should I support it? There's no big picture of what this church as an institution hopes to and can offer the larger community, but it needs to be sustained by everyone. I bump into people all the time while shopping at Dan's or at a party or sometimes just standing waiting for an elevator. And I will be approached. Someone will come over and say, oh my goodness, good to see you. I used to go to your church. And I never quite know how to respond to someone who says, well, I used to go to the church. And I, you know, would be inclined to say, God, those were the good old days. Won't you come back? You know, we miss you, all those things. But I don't go there. I usually say nothing. But lately, I've changed the tune just a little bit. And I say, oh, interesting, so you no longer go to this church. Are you now involved in a new church community? And the response is downright anger. Oh, no, never. I mean, if I were going to church, it would be the Unitarian Church. And I go, whew, that's a relief. Wow, that's good to know. Our congregation can do a far better job of hospitality. Can the stranger really see a welcoming light in this church. Now, to be sure, we are an extremely warm and friendly church to the people we already know. We need to open our arms a little wider so that those who are looking for a liberal church that will matter in their lives will not turn away in dismay. Back to volunteerism. Getting volunteers here is like getting Republicans to endorse Donald Trump. It's sort of like, no. Thinking about it, but no. We desperately lack for people to staff our welcoming table, to usher and greet people on Sunday mornings, make coffee, to fill the vacancies on our social justice council. How telling is that? It's hard to fill the vacancies on our social justice council. Remember the light, that beacon light? And perhaps more unbelievably, we're lacking people to teach our children, that is, to nourish our future and reverse the appalling decline in religious education that adversely affects not just us, but our whole denomination. And individually, each one of us must ask, have we let our busy lives overwhelm us to the point where we drop into church on occasion and show our kids every once in a while, but without any real role or commitment? I firmly believe deep down that using the lighthouse metaphor in our reading this morning, we want for this church to guide our city away from the dangerous shoals. We truly believe that we have much to offer, not only to our membership, but actually to the whole Salt Lake Valley. So may we promise ourselves to widen our friendship circles and offer a few precious hours to attend to those indispensable functions around this church. And then we can integrate all those new families into the life of this church and come to appreciate that we have not outlived our usefulness. This church remains an essential place, does it not, in our lives and in our region. So may we move forward in love among all who enter this community and make efforts to strengthen this church as a leading influence in this community and remind ourselves of the personal investment we must make in order not to relinquish our past historical significance. I think this may be continued at our annual meeting, and in the interest of time, we're going to skip closing words and hymn and just, let me just douse the chalice and just listen to the fine music of David.